Oh, start recording now. Fuck it. We'll do it live.
Okay, everyone be quiet. You guys ready?
And welcome to another episode of 72 Pin Connector. With us today, we have Tom Webster.
Howdy, everyone.
And Adam Jordan.
Hello. Hey.
So, how are you guys doing today?
Oh my god. This fucking week. Again.
Is it as bad as last week?
Yeah. Yeah. Last week was crazy. This week is crazy. But I have been playing a great game that not many people have been playing. It's called Job Simulator IRL.
Oh, actual job.
And it is great. I've in this new version of Job Simulator, I've done everything from fill out paperwork, fill out I-9 authorization forms, prove that I'm a U.S. citizen, and all kinds of other fun stuff. And it looks like I have even more of this game left to go next week before it's all said and complete. The story kind of sucks. The gameplay is really annoying, but it does have this great, it evokes the actual horribleness of moving to a new job and doing a bunch of new job paperwork. So I can't really complain. It's very accurate.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, I have not been doing that kind of shit. I had a friend in town, so I didn't do a whole lot of gaming at the beginning of the week. But yeah, it's been a pretty relaxed week. The last couple of days, I've been like, fuck it, sit back, not do much.
But, it's always a good feeling.
So we moved out here. We had this understanding that we are not going to do touristy stuff on our own. We are not going to go out. We're not going to do the Space Needle. We're not going to go out and see like all the museums and stuff. Uh-huh. Because we knew once people would be coming in that we'd be doing that stuff. And lo and behold, people come in, we start doing that stuff.
Nice.
So it's like,
that was smart though.
Well, yeah, because I mean, someone comes out to visit, they're going to want to see that shit. And I can't blame.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. I don't want to pay to see that shit twice. Well, correction, I will pay to see it twice. I don't want to pay to see it five fucking times.
Right. That's a big difference there.
So I'll just wait and then it'll be good.
That makes sense.
What about you, Adam? How's your week been?
Pretty easy. Work's been going well. Not really a lot to say, really. Just been a nice, pleasant week.
With that pleasant week, you've been able to do much gaming then, so it's been nice and low-key?
Yeah, a bit. A lot of the same games, but yeah. Played some Rocket League, played some Battlegrounds, played some Binding of Isaac. Which I did stream a little bit of today.
Nice.
Oh, really? So, that was a lot of fun getting back into that. I'm going to start playing that more often for sure. I ran into a bunch of new stuff I haven't seen yet because I bought that Afterbirth Plus expansion and then like played it for a couple of days and that's it. So I'm seeing new items and stuff. So it was a lot of fun.
I still don't have that expansion.
You haven't bought that yet?
Why? No. I don't. I intend on buying it. I just don't know what I want to buy it on.
Oh yeah, because have you played it? Have you played it much on the Switch?
I haven't played it at all on the Switch.
Okay,
and I'm kind of excited to play it on the Switch. I think it's a great game for handheld, especially since you can just stop where you're at and just go back.
Right,
but
now, is that out? Is it out on Switch yet?
Yes.
Okay, I thought so, but I wasn't sure.
I would have to pay $40 for it on Switch.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Or I could just buy the DLC and that's it.
Yeah,
which is 15. Definitely 15. It's $15.
I think so. I thought it was. Yeah.
Since I don't, it own was it cheaper in the first place. I think I might just get it on the Switch.
Yeah, if you don't have it at all, and
that's
you're gonna
probably the best bet.
Yeah, especially since it's not a multiplayer experience. You don't need to be playing with other people, so it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if the seating still works cross console.
I would assume that it would still work. I mean, I can't guarantee it because I haven't done it, but I would imagine. Mm-hmm. Actually, I can test that this weekend. I do know someone who has it on the Switch.
Okay,
so
cool.
I'll going to
give it a try. Yeah, definitely curious.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know what he's talking about, The Binding of Isaac, when they came out with the Afterbirth and all that, they allowed you to see the seed that generated your game. Since it's roguelike, it's all procedurally generated off a given seed. And so since it tells you, you can give that seed to your friend and say, hey, this is a fucking sweet run. Check it out. And they can play that run. And they can go through and they may end up with a completely different thing because they did different decisions, but all mm-hmm. the random decisions are the same. So it's really kind of cool.
I've seen other streamer people do this before, but it's really fun if you all get together, you know, you and a friend or two or whatever. One person generates a seed, gives it to the rest of them, and you all play through the same run. And you can do, you know, races, who can beat first, you know, who can beat it first or who can get the furthest in that run. You know, people make different decisions on what they do and end up with different items. It's really interesting.
That would actually be really fun to do.
We should do that. We should do that today or tomorrow or the next day. Maybe the day after.
We should
do that soon. The day after. I'm very busy.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'll pencil you in somewhere.
But to do it in general, you do have to have the game.
Oh.
There is a prerequisite to play the game. You're going to
need
the game.
Yeah. You're going to need that game. Yeah, for sure.
Fuck you guys. I don't want it. Believe it or not, I have gotten in a couple smaller games. I played the first hour of Stardew Valley. And right now I have no idea, absolutely no idea, how the devs weren't sued into oblivion because it literally carbon copies. And I know that, you know, the first hour is not indicative of the rest of the game, but the entire introduction is literally every single Harvest Moon game. Someone gives you a farm, you have to meet the people, and you have to pull weeds. And that is the entirety of every Harvest Moon game ever created. And that's how this one starts out, too. Not that it's a bad thing. It's a very familiar, warm feeling, but still, it's a carbon copy.
Well, it's kind of hard to get a storyline where, hey, this is a guy in the 21st century who's a developer. Yeah. What in the fuck is going to make him move to the country and start a farm?
You know what I would love to see? I'd love to mix Harvest Moon with like a post-apocalyptic survival game, like a zombie apocalypse game. Well, probably not zombie apocalypse, but like have nuclear war, like tear the world apart and destroy all the electronics. So you have no choice but to start farming. So it's got the survivalist aspects with the Harvest Moon stuff.
So have you ever heard of Don't Starve?
That's kind of what came to mind when you said that.
I guess that's true.
I mean, if you're just a casual player on Don't Starve, you may not notice it. But as you get later in the game, you are going to be making advanced farms. You're going to be domesticating animals to get things out of them. Well, I shouldn't say domesticating. You're going to have certain animals that you can domesticate and others that you just manage and know where they're at and manage the herds. So Harvest Moon does have an element of that. But Don't Starve, but it's fucking brutal.
Yeah,
that's what I've heard. I never got into it. I watched a lot of it being played, but I never dove into it myself. And then
it's fun.
Then after that, I did what I said I was going to do. I played a tiny bit, probably 2-3 hours of Hyper Light Drifter. And I have no idea what's going on in the game. I have no idea what the story is. All I know is that there are like these bear like creatures and they fuck me up. So I have to stab them.
Bear creatures.
That game,
something that. I don't know. They're green. They like run at you and try to swipe at you with claws or something. No idea.
Rawr. Yeah. Bears.
And then there's this crystal dude and I shot him in the face, which is kind of cool. And I upgraded my guy a little bit. So that was fun. I think I'm starting to understand the game. It does the Dark Souls thing where it doesn't tell you fucking anything. There's some text at the beginning that says, here's how you change your controls. Here's how you change your resolution. Other than that, go fuck yourself. Yeah. So like even like the NPCs that you can talk to, they don't use words. Like this must have been the easiest game in the world to localize. They just talk in pictures. So you don't even know the story because you can only infer so much from an image. It's odd.
That's really interesting, though.
Yeah, like
that's
like
cool.
One NPC was talking about from what I've gathered, right? I could be totally off base, but I think there's this dude in pink armor with a badass helmet, and I think he saved this guy's life because he was being attacked by like some creatures, and like one frame shows a guy like bleeding on the ground. The next frame shows like all the enemies cowering in like the shadow of this hero wearing armor. And then the next frame would show the dude in pink armor like standing guard over the bloodied body of the guy you're talking to. I was like, okay, cool. So pink knight dude is probably a badass and he's probably a good guy. So, and then I actually got to see him fight some enemies when I came to like this clearing, and he was just kicking all kinds of ass. So nice. I tried to talk to him and he doesn't really say much. He's like, oh, hey, there's some shit over here. And he marked some stuff on my map. I'm like, okay,
yeah.
Is that good? Are they shops? Are they treasures? Is it stuff that'll kill me? Is it poisonous gas? He's just like, here's some shit over here. And then he didn't say anything else. It's like, okay, cool. Huh.
It's probably a little bit of all of the above.
Probably. It's interesting. It's a good game. But it definitely has that beginning of Dark Souls feeling where you have no idea what's going on. But the game is fucking beautiful. Everything, the pixel art, the effects, absolutely beautiful.
And the soundtrack yes. to that game is so good. I haven't played the game at all. I haven't even really watched gameplay. I think I watched the trailer on the Steam page or whatever, but I've listened to that soundtrack more than once all the way through. It's really good. Really good.
So yeah. the chat has brought up something that we absolutely forgot last week. And I know this is why you come to 72 Pin Connector. I would like to talk about Dragon Sauce. Last week,
Dragon Sauce,
and the thing that's even better than Dragon Sauce, because Dragon Sauce was good. Did I mess up our transition?
Yeah, I already had something planned out to get us into there a little more smoothly.
Right, hey,
we're in it, man. Just jump into
okay.
it.
Okay. All right. So
what about
we went to this? What in any other area of the country, this would be considered a dive bar. We walked into this place and I'm like, oh, fuck yeah. It's probably like, you know, $2 drinks. It wasn't like a dive bar.
It's not. Okay. Dive bar is cash only. You get bottles of Bud Light and there's a cigarette machine in the corner next to a beat up pinball machine.
Okay. Okay. It wasn't a dive bar. You
clearly have never been to Flavor Town, but there are more to dives than just that. I mean,
so it was not a highfalutin establishment is what I'm getting at. But this was in the heart of Seattle. So we open up a menu and I'm expecting, okay, here's your fucking meat and bread burger and your shitty tater tots and, you know, just the fucking bar food. No, I open up the menu to here's your braised Kobe beef burger with palm frites and your wedge salad with homemade French Italian bullshit. And like all the words are super long and all the dishes. Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like super pricey, but for bar food, it was fucking pricey.
So it's not really a bar. It is a restaurant.
It is a restaurant.
So what Tom's not used to yet is he's out in Seattle and he's not used to trendy fuckers with hair or with man buns is his issue.
Yeah, totally not used to it.
This is like all wood. Everything is like wood, old school looking. It's got weird ass fucking lighting. Some trendy ass music going the entire time. They serve their own house made coffee and
nice.
The one cool thing is they had like what 60, 70 beers on tap.
It was legit. This place was cool.
Nice. Oh, and for the record, just so everyone knows, I live in Seattle. I fucking hate the trendy shit. I am not one of these hipster guys. No, my hair gets long because I'm lazy as shit and I don't go to the barber. Not because I'm growing it out.
I like to tell people I'm not a hipster, but my wife says I'm a hipster, so I guess that makes me a hipster because I hate hipsters. But yeah, so we got the large palm frites plate thing for the table with dragon sauce, which was kind of like a spicy mayo with a weird like seasoning kick. It was odd. It was good, but it was odd. It was all right. My favorite thing though is their house-made curry ketchup. They make ketchup with curry powder. Oh. So not only do you get like the sweetness of the ketchup, but now it's got this amazing
sounds good on curry, fries.
Yeah, this curry flavoring to it. Oh my god, I couldn't stop. It was the most delicious ketchup I've ever had in my entire life.
So,
and it was hipster as fuck.
Well, what makes it possibly not quite a sip? Well, I gotta watch how I say this. So the bottle they brought it in looked like a Heinz 57 glass bottle with the labels ripped off. The ketchup flavor itself was similar to Heinz, except for, like he said, it was curry. It just tasted like they put some curry powder or something in with it. And it's really good. Mm. It's just, it looks amazing. Like a Heinz 57 bottle.
It's absolutely amazing. And the fries were of this perfect, like, crispy consistency. Like, they were fried just enough. None of them were burnt, but they were. They all had a crisp to them. It was, and I'm sure they had, like, sea
fries
salt.
Have to have a crisp.
Sea salt, like, shaved off the bottom of, like, some otter somewhere in the ocean or some kind of bullshit.
Renewably done, though.
Yes, renewable otter salt.
Barrel-aged sea salt.
Yeah. Jesus fucking Christ. And
so they call it Fritz, and Tom referenced Fritz. They're just fucking fries.
They're fucking French fries.
And really, at that, they're fucking carnival fries is how they're cooked.
Carnival fries?
Like fair fries. Like the type that you get and you like douse in malt vinegar. And if you don't douse them in malt vinegar, you're just fucking doing it wrong. But it was those kind of fries.
I love really some good. Malt vinegar.
But curry ketchup? Oh my fucking God, curry ketchup.
That's a good idea. And you could do that at home real easy.
Yeah.
But you could just buy some curry powder or garam masala or whatever. And
so there's one thing that we did miss, though. Oh, when we left, we found out there was a whiskey and beer fest across the street.
Oh, yes, we did.
It was $40 for 8 beers and a flight of shots to try. So it would be like 5 different shots and 8 beers for $40.
Actually,
that's pretty good for like whiskey.
Especially in the middle of downtown solid. Seattle.
Yeah. And you know it's going to be some fancy aged stuff too, not like, here's some Jack, here's some Jim.
Right, yeah, it's going to be
we got you the Jack stuff. Daniels honey version.
The private stock Jack is really good. I will never turn that down. That is actually really smooth stock? And good. Yes.
I don't know if I can be about my...
Gentleman's Jack,
I guess? No, that's what I meant. It's Gentleman's Jack.
Okay, I thought you were talking about something else.
Yeah, that's really good. It's super smooth.
I haven't had it.
I don't know if I can be like fancy about my whiskey. I don't really care for Jack Daniels, but I like Bullet, which is it is not a fancy brand. It is the college brand. But I fucking love me some Bullet Rye.
Rye. Anything Bullet Rye.
Bullet Rye. Over rocks. It's got to be over rocks.
But
oh man.
That was our fun night on the town getting some weird food. Oh, and they didn't have burgers. That was the one thing. It was all lamb. Lamb burgers.
Lamb is good, though.
It normally is. I agree. But this tasted like it was a regular hamburger fried in a skillet to be cooked. It had that kind of flavor to it to me. It didn't taste grilled. Didn't have like, it was cooked in its own fat and juices, which is typically good, but it's just, it was weird.
I think I got like a fish thing. I don't even remember.
You got fish and chips.
I did get fish and chips. The fish was okay. it was all right. It wasn't amazing. But they gave me like this potato lasagna. Like, you know how scalloped potatoes are like the sort of thin sliced in like maybe a gravy, maybe a cheese sauce, maybe like a potato gravy of some kind. It was scalloped potatoes, but stacked up lasagna style. So you could chop it with a fork and eat just fucking potato slices. And it was the best part of the meal. It's the weirdest, stupidest thing, but I love potato lasagna.
Huh.
And it was not called potato lasagna. It had a very fancy name to it, but it was fucking potato lasagna. Let's get real.
Well, because for every syllable they add to the description of the food, they get to add $5.
That is accurate.
Yeah, probably.
Just so much cooler.
But we digress.
Yes. So, is that all you had to play this week, Tom?
I played a little bit of Shovel Knight, probably like an hour-ish.
How is it?
I love Shovel Knight. I absolutely love Shovel Knight, but I can only play it so long because it reminds me so much of my childhood. Meaning that the game is just fucking hard. Everything in that game will kill you. It doesn't give a fuck. There's no easy mode. There are like these wandering bosses in the map. So it's just like, oh yeah, I'm going to fuck this guy up. Fuck him, right? I've got fireballs now. And he kicked my ass like 3 times. So I decided to play some Hyperlight Drifter instead. It's an NES game in the music, in the graphics, in the controls, in every way that counts, and an NES game in difficulty because it will fuck you up.
Yeah, nice. I've been tempted to pick it up on the Switch. My buddy's been talking so high about it, and with the lack of games on the Switch, it's tempting, but I still haven't done it yet.
Yeah, I've debated on that game too.
Especially now on the PC, you can do co-op play, and they've got a lot of extras built in. Like they've just bolted more stuff onto the game. So totally worth picking up.
Hmm. Nice.
And I'm assuming with everything else, that's probably the finale of your week.
Yeah, that is it. The rest has been job simulator or new job simulator, I should say.
Form, paperwork. Wait. Yep.
Benefits, healthcare, healthcare.
401k.
Okay, we're going to have to clip that out. I think we have an outro right there.
So I've been getting into a little bit of some stuff. I obviously did Rocket League as norm. I kept going in some Has-Been Heroes. That game gets rough. That game gets super hard. I mean, it is the hardest roguelike I've played. It gets stupid difficult. Did a little bit of a oddball game that I've never really played before. Lovers in a Dangerous Time Space. Or Spacetime, not Time Space, sorry.
I've heard of this.
So
I have not.
This is very interesting. It's a great couch co-op game. Absolutely great couch co-op game. You have this ship, and the ship has stations. So think Artemis kind of thing, where you have, bad example, don't think Artemis. So it's 2D pixely. You have a gun at the top, right, left, and bottom. You have in the very center a drive console. At the top right, you have like a map. At the top left, you have this weird power gun that just rotates and you tell it when to shoot. You can only control what you're at the station of. So we had three of us. So one person would be driving around, one person would be shooting and jumping around different stations to shoot, and the other person would be controlling the shield. Because you get a shield, but it only covers about a fifth of your ship. So you have to move it around to block stuff. And your goal is, it's kind of like a fetchy game. You go, you find these things, you collect them, it unlocks the exit. But there's a shit ton of enemies. And every time you collect something, these alarms go off, everything spawns in, all hell breaks loose. And it's really fun. It's tricky to control. And since there's so many stations with so few people, you have to do a lot of coordination when you're jumping around. But it's really interesting.
Now, was that part of the Humble Freedom Bundle?
No. Okay. I was playing this through my Steam Link whenever my friend was in town. He had it and he's like, hey, it's a good couch co-op. Let's do it. So I tried it out. Cool. It was pretty fun. It's just, it's a little different. It's
different.
Yeah, I don't know how to really explain it, like to compare it to a game. Kind of Geometry Wars when it comes to the shooting aspect of it and flying, but it's more navigating an actual world than it is just blindly killing shit. It's definitely interesting. If you can find it for cheap and you like couch co-ops, I think it's a really good pickup.
That might be fun. I might have to check that out.
It's definitely worth a look at, but don't pay full price.
Okay.
Fair enough.
And other than that, I went back and played some more Battlegrounds. And I only bring that up because Battlegrounds this week isn't the same as Battlegrounds last week. They just had a really big patch. And this patch did a ton. I mean, literally a ton for the game. They brought in two weapon types. They have a crossbow, which is insanely powerful. Stupid low reload speed and a stupid low range. And they brought in Adam?
The crossbow, I think, was in a previous update. They took it out for a while, and now they brought it back.
So rebalancing and all that fun stuff?
Probably, I would assume.
So, I mean, that's definitely good, strong weapon. It's fun because the arrow's sticking you. So if you don't kill them with it, the arrow sticks in their body.
Nice.
It's a feature straight out of 1999 with Perfect Dark.
Yes. But that was 99.
This update seems to have
That would have been like 97 or anything. Either way. What were you saying, Adam?
The update seems to have a lot of little quality of life improvements.
Yes.
like your map, what you can set the marker down on the map to mark a spot. That's actually visible by the whole team now, and everybody can put their own colored marker on the map, so it makes things a little easier to coordinate, like when you're jumping from the plane or deciding on where to go next.
Yeah,
makes, very, very helpful.
That's nice.
Yeah, because otherwise it gets a really complicated trying to say, hey, that house over there southeast, well, there's three houses. Which one? Oh, the double-decker. There's two of them. Which one? Oh, the one that has a red roof. Oh, I'm dead already.
And it's not like you can say, oh, it's the one to the left, because depending on your orientation, that could totally fuck someone.
Yeah, well, that's why at the top they have your actual bearings, and those are definitely the best way of calling stuff out is by actual bearings.
Yes. Yes.
But some of the other stuff this did is, well, there was another weapon, the Vector. It's an SMG. I can't remember what other games have the Vector. It's not in a lot of video games, but it's just a short to mid-range SMG, super fast fire. Not a whole lot of damage, but it throws a whole lot of bullets at you.
Does it fill a niche that was missing in the game before? Like, does it do what other guns couldn't or haven't done as well? Or is it just I'm throwing a gun into a game because reasons?
It's a better version of the Uzi.
From what I understand, it shoots bigger rounds than the other two SMGs do. So I think its potential for damage output is higher, but it might be a lower range than the others. I'm not sure.
Because it's definitely a longer range than the Uzi. But this game, bullets determine the damage. So your caliber is your driver.
Oh, that's nice.
So it makes it pretty nice when it comes to, okay, it's a 5.56 gun, it's a 7.62. 7.62 is going to do more damage, but typically your 5.56 guns, your SCAR, your M16, your M4 are more accurate and so on and so forth. But a cool part of this update, the frying pan. The cast iron frying pan that was going to transition us into food cast until Tom decided to jump balls deep.
My bad.
So what the frying pan does now is it stops bullets. If someone shoots at you and they hit your frying pan that's on your back or in your hand, worked as a shield, it will stop. It has been able to stop the strongest of the sniper rifles.
What the shit?
It just makes this loud, resounding ping sound and no damage. Just happened to hit you in the frying pan. No, it's really cool. I actually saw a video of this guy streaming it on Twitch, and him and his teammate were in this encounter with enemies, and they were not winning this encounter with enemies. And he was like trying to hide behind a tree, and he like turns and somebody shoots him, and he's got like a sliver of health left. And he turns again and somebody shoots from a different place and it hits the pan and it saves him. And then he's able to run away and he gets away. And then they end up killing those guys.
Jesus.
And he's like, this frying pan saved my life.
Yeah. So is this like kind of a tone change in Battlegrounds? Because from what I've seen, and again, I haven't played it, Battlegrounds is kind of, I wouldn't say like super serious, but it's serious-ish. Is this like sort of a slapstick change in tone, or is it just something like a funny item?
So I don't want to call it slapstick because have you ever held a cast iron skillet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah.
I just got one recently.
You could kill a man with a cast iron skillet fairly easily.
I honestly want to try it because I would almost guarantee like 7.62 and stuff like that. I have no doubt it would not get through. That said, there's a reason bulletproof vests aren't made with that shit, because that shit's heavy as fuck.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I just like, are you able to hold multiple or strap them on your body? Because I want the cast iron knight is what
armor.
I want.
Yeah, the cast iron knight.
No, but games.
I want the black iron Tarkus of Battlegrounds to walk in. Kung, kung, kung.
It was really funny though.
Can you smell what I'm cooking? And then go into battle like that.
I'm about to unplug your mic for that.
I believe last cast we talked about this briefly, but I think you just named the title of our upcoming hardcore cooking game, Cast Iron Knight.
Yes. Goddamn yes.
It's perfect.
So GameSpot's their article about this update, the big thing that's always been the big picture is just that guy kind of going through the explosions with a normal shirt on.
Yeah.
They just superimposed all these frying pans over him as in a suit of armor. And yeah, I mean, it's a funny little change. It makes sense. It's clever and it's not going to change anything.
Right.
Maybe one out of every 1,000 times it's going to help you. But what it will do is if you see a frying pan,
you're going to pick it up.
You're going to pick it up. I almost said 9 times out of 10. I'm like, no, 10 out of 10, you're picking it up.
I want to see like the Battlegrounds eSports competition where the frying pan wins the goddamn game.
So yeah, I've seen a video where someone's in a car in a passenger seat. The other person running up to it doesn't realize, drives in or jumps in the driver's seat, takes off. The other person pulls out the skillet and kills them with the skillet.
Jesus.
No way.
And you just hear this ding. It's like, yes, that's got to feel so satisfying.
Good shit.
Even without vibration feedback, that's got to feel so good.
I had a great moment in Counter-Strike. It was either last week or the week before, where me and this guy ran towards each other with AKs. We unloaded our clips. We were totally empty. He pulls out his pistol, and I think it was a Deagle, so it's super powerful but pretty slow. And I pull out my knife, and in perfect Counter-Strike fashion, I slice him in the face. I totally won that encounter and died like 3 seconds later because his buddy shot me. But it's those moments. That's why we play video games.
Yes.
But some of the other quality of life stuff that did come out of this. Previously, low graphic setting and high graphic setting was more than performance. In high graphic setting, there was a ton of foliage. In low graphic setting, probably about 2/3 of that foliage goes away.
Oh, that's huge.
So what happens is by playing in high mode, you think you're hiding in a bush. Someone comes up to you in low graphic setting, to them, you're in the middle of fucking nowhere. No bush.
Yeah.
Wow.
So they balance that out to where all foliage is the same on all settings.
That's good.
And
that's
speaking of which, we used that to our advantage recently. We got to like the last little, the circle was zoning in, and it was right at the end of the match. I think there was 10, 12 people left or something. And it zeroes in, we're in these houses, and the next zone is, we're not in the zone anymore in the houses, so we had to move. But outside of the houses, it was just like a field. It's just wide open. We knew we were going to die. So we've run out into this field, and there's these bushes. There's one every 30 feet or so. So we go up to these bushes, and we stand inside one and crouch down. And it pretty much covers you completely. So we're in the middle of this field in these bushes, and nobody's seeing us. We're totally safe. And
You even got a revive out of that, didn't you?
Yeah. One guy actually, he was not in the bushes and he engaged an enemy. Somebody shot him. He got downed and he's like slowly crawling back over towards the bushes. And I was able to revive him from my bush and we all survived that particular encounter.
Good God. So,
foliage stress for real. Yeah.
So back in the day, there used to be this option called bright skins. And I think modern shooters are getting away with it. But basically, if you wanted to, you could make all player characters like essentially glow. I think it was a setting in Unreal Tournament. I could be wrong on this. But by turning that option on, you made yourself glow as well. So even if you didn't have bright skins turned on, if someone else did, you could fucking see them because they stood out like a sore thumb, especially in like sniper maps and Unreal Tournament. So... yes, it helped you identify other players, but it also made you very, very vulnerable because you were the only glowing thing on the map.
Wow.
And
that's interesting.
That's not a good thing. That's not a good thing
so,
at all.
No.
So I'm pretty sure that everyone got rid of that setting for a reason.
Well, of course. I mean, you don't want to be the one guy just running around glowing orange going, hey, everyone, take a shot at me.
Right.
Yep. Yeah.
But yeah, so other things they did, some small things, which was actually, I don't want to say good or bad, but to me, I have a 1080 and I took a performance hit on this update because of this, I think. They previously, I guess, were putting a lot of the load on CPUs. And and now they've switched it to where a lot more of the load is going back to the GPU. And I don't know yet. I haven't heard anything, but I'm imagining this is actually going to make the game unplayable for some people that it was barely playable for to start with. Because I think people tend to have CPUs that are strong enough, but GPUs, people will try to hold on to an old GPU for some time.
It really depends. Like in my rig, I've got a 980 Ti, but my processor is like second gen i5. It's nothing to write home about at all.
Here's the thing, a second gen i5 is still probably 60% as strong as a current gen i5.
Yeah, that's
where
true.
A 5 gen ago graphics card is nowhere near that strong of a graphics card now.
Right, right. I would be interested to, and I mean, the developers, if they've built their game to do this, and most games do, they know what their players are running, and they know the type of impact they're going to have on a game when they change something like that.
And I'm hoping that's right, because I don't want this game to stop. I really love this game, but
yeah,
we'll see.
Yeah.
But that was pretty much it for the update. I know I took a performance hit. I have current gen i7 and a 1080, and I took a hit. So I can't imagine what's happening to other people. Well, you had to adjust your settings too, didn't you, Adam?
Yeah. Well, I was already kind of messing with them anyway, just to try to get it to look decent with, you know, a good frame rate or whatever. I might have taken a little bit of a hit if I did. It's not that much, but I'm not really sure because I've been playing with the settings and changing them and stuff. But the update's supposed to be for the people with like minimum system requirements. It's supposed to run better for them.
Hmm.
So I think that's what their focus was. That's what their focus was with that.
If that's the case, that'd be great. I just didn't know.
Mm. Yeah.
Kind of help expand your player base a little bit.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Especially in early access when you can afford to take those kinds of risks. That's a good thing.
Yeah. That's the biggest caveat of buying this game in early access is that it's not really optimized that well. So, you know, if they can get the people with minimum specs to, you know, run the game well enough to feel comfortable buying it or playing it, you know, then that's excellent.
Yeah, that's kind of the case for most early access games. Is optimization is an afterthought. But, you know, as you know, if you're trying to optimize every little step and make every little thing perfect, you'll never get a game out the door. You build what works and then you polish later.
And you walk in with the understanding not everyone's going to be able to play this game.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Just understood.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there also was some other interesting news that came out. Some stats came out, and this kind of vindicates Microsoft from what they were trying to do 6 years ago with the Xbox One.
Yep.
So everyone was in a fussy. Xbox One was announced to be an online-only console, and everything was going to be digital. Everyone went up in arms because console guys don't like digital.
Well, not necessarily. So what happened was the console wasn't 100% digital. You could still buy your discs at a store and take them home, and it would install the game from the disc. But that disc would, essentially each disc would be serial numbered, and it would be tied to your account. So you couldn't sell the game back. You couldn't give the game away unless you turned it into an authorized retailer. Or you went through this weird digital process to move your licenses between accounts instead of like me saying, hey, Irk, here's this game and handing it to you. It was a process. It turned used games and gifting games into an actual event instead of just handing someone a disc. That's what people hated.
No. The original Xbox One plan that when they started protesting was strictly digital. They weren't going to have a disc tray.
If they would have kept that, it would have been fine. I would have been fine with it. The issue...
Well, you're not a console guy.
I'm not, but...
That's what I'm saying. Console guys hated it.
If you have a disc tray, there are certain expectations on how I can use this piece of hardware.
They weren't going to have a disc tray.
In the thing that they were protesting was not in the original spec. The with E3? Are you talking about around E3?
No,
E3,
I'm saying it was after E3 because the guy came out, he was in a press interview, and they asked him, why did it always online? What if I'm offline? That's when he the notorious quote of, that's what the 360's for.
Right, right. No, the system had a disc tray at that time. I am unaware of any time when the Xbox One did not have a...
Yeah, it was initially only digital. And that's when everyone's like, well, I don't like digital.
It wasn't that way at E3. I know that. Because Sony, you know, classically owned Microsoft in that E3 presentation. Because the CEO of Sony at the time came out and he said, okay, we're going to show you how borrowing games works on the PS4. And he took a disc and he handed it to the guy next to him. And the guy raised up the disc. He's like, cool, I got a game. And they said, and that's the process. And everyone went fucking nuts. They just mic dropped all over the place at E3.
I remember that. That was great.
But either way, what I was getting at is 75% or just under 75% of all sales are digital. Is what it just came out.
Mm-hmm.
So
I'm not surprised. I'm really not surprised at all. I mean, it's just convenient.
But the one, this number includes mobile, Steam, console, everything.
Oh, okay.
Counting mobile in there,
yeah,
it really throws your fucking numbers, because I don't know of any, and I could be wrong, and I would love to be proved wrong, because I actually want to know if this exists. I don't know of any cartridge I can put in my Android phone right now that would give me a video game other than like an SD card with an APK on it.
Oh, I was going to ask. I mean, there's all sorts. It's just not quite legal.
Right, right. So, or if I have a goddamn N-Gage, which we're going back in time for that one. But mobile really, really throws it off, because every game you get on mobile is a digital download.
And you said Steam was part of that too?
Yeah, Steam.
That throws it off. I would like to see...
It's saying game sales in general. Of course, Steam's can be digital. What it's trying to say is that the game market is getting away from physical copies.
The overall market, not just the console market.
I think these stats would have... It's an interesting statistic. And it does have some meaning, but I think it loses a lot of meaning by not exclusively focusing on consoles or handhelds that are cartridge based or disc based. So, you know, throw in your PSP, throw in your DS, and take your, you know, Nintendo, Sony, and Microsoft consoles. By throwing PC and mobile in there, you skew those numbers far to one side, because physical PC releases do not exist anymore. The only physical PC release that exists right now that actually sells are World of Warcraft expansion packs.
Well, you have stuff like, I think Rocket League had a physical release for PC too.
Still don't know why they did that.
Because the same reason it did.
This is like
for
a collector's thing. It came with like a little poster decal thing. And at the time, it came with cars earlier than you could buy them from DLC. So you got that early access to those cars. Yeah.
So that's cool, but that's definitely not going to make up the majority of your sales, right?
No,
PC sales,
not.
All PC games, right, with relatively few exceptions, are digital. They're bought and sold digital. But it's this is interesting. Everyone has known that the industry was moving towards a digital only, you know, marketplace for a while now. I guess it's nice to see some numbers backing that, even if they don't mean as much as they could.
Well, I still think it holds a lot, because look what's happening with GameStops. GameStops are starting to falter a lot.
I mean, that sucks. Sorry for GameStop. I fucking hate GameStop.
But I would like to see the numbers of exclusively console games. How many are purely digital versus people that went to the store and actually bought the game?
I think you're going to get close to 50% because of arcade games. And you can't exclude those, because those actually make up a good bit of what people play on Xbox and stuff.
I think the best numbers to look at are releases, you know, launched at the same time, digital and physical releases. So look at something like, you know, Mass Effect and Call of Duty and stuff that came out where you can download it on the PlayStation Store or you can buy a disc for it. And compare those numbers. That's going to be the real tell of whether or not physical games are starting to go away. If you're including the mobile market is fucking huge, right? If you look at like the numbers where Nintendo was owning everything forever with their handhelds, it went away after the iPhone. Nintendo's leadership dissolved after the iPhone in the handheld space. Mobile throws that a lot.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I think if you focus in on these numbers, and then did they make the data set public? Can we run those numbers? I mean, not right now, but eventually.
I am not sure if they were actually all the way public or not.
Okay. I would love to actually get a hold of those numbers and do some comparisons myself, because I'm sure it's moving towards a digital only future. I don't think it's as crazy as this 75% figure. Even still, it gives us a decent direction on where the industry is heading.
It is, because indies. I think indies are help driving this, because indies can't make physical releases, and people on consoles do enjoy indies. I mean, Braid.
Yeah.
I discovered Braid on an Xbox 360.
Right.
I discovered Limbo on an Xbox 360. Same with Bastion. And those aren't physical at all.
The Xbox Live Arcade is the best thing to happen to indie games since...
Yeah.
Computers, I guess.
And now the Switch looking to be that, so hopefully that trend will stay.
That'll be nice.
If the Switch continues to be an indie powerhouse, it's going to drastically increase my chances of buying one. Like very drastically.
I will say,
I've never been a Nintendo guy. I don't really care that much about Nintendo games. Even games like Mario Kart, which are very fun, I'm not like a huge fanboy of. So it's not gonna make me buy that console. But if they start getting a lot of these indie releases on there, I'm gonna consider it strongly.
I'm not a big fanboy of any of the stuff they've done.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I shouldn't say it, maybe a little bit, but the console is just so good.
Yeah,
it feels good. It's aesthetically pleasing. Just. I want to play stuff on that game or that console. I think it's a big thing going for it, but we'll see. I think that this is hopefully going to put the nail in the GameStop coffin.
That'll be nice.
And once they turn into nothing but merchandise, I'll be happy because I'll never have to go there again.
You know, I did the last time I went to a GameStop, was to buy a Steam gift card because amazingly enough, and I need to like send Gabe an email and be like, dude, what's up? You can't just buy Steam money and give it to someone online. There is no online mechanism to just send someone a digital Steam gift card within the Steam interface. There are plenty of third-party sites that claim to do it. I don't trust them. I've never used them, so I can't really speak from experience. But the only way I was able to give a Steam gift card to someone is to go to a store and pay with money and get a physical object for some stupid code and then send that to them.
Microsoft has had the same issues with that too.
I don't understand why I can't just go and buy something. It's digital anyway, right? It starts digital, it ends digital. Your games are digital.
Yeah. Right.
Why couldn't I do that within Steam?
You need to be able to. And I think their big fear is fraud. Because once you get someone compromises your account, they buy $100 in gift cards and then they distribute it to people. And sorry for that flash, people watching the stream. We knew we were getting dark and we were taking care of it.
We've got a production crew that's walking by right now.
So digital, way of the future. We know this.
And absolutely.
Things are starting to show it. Also, things of the future. The Asian Games 2022 is going to have eSports in it.
72-pin connector is now officially announcing our pivot from an internet startup to an eSports management company team. We are dropping the podcast. We're dropping the website. We're dropping everything, and we're focusing exclusively on Battlegrounds as the future eSport.
Yeah, that will never happen. But I didn't look into it too deep. I think they are adding League, and I don't know what else, maybe probably a StarCraft or something. But in 2018, they're running it as a trial on the Asian Games. And then 2022, they are actually doing a full-scale thing with it.
I like that Asia is kind of leading this charge because esports have always been more accepted out there, right? I know you know, people like my father and my father's age, people, whenever Dota 2 rolls around and TI shows up on ESPN, they're all swearing at the TV, what are these goddamn video games doing on my ESPN?
Right.
It's not really that way in Asia, especially in China, where teams like eHome are celebrated like the best sports stars here in America. They're praised like fucking NFL teams over there. It's like you can watch Sunday Night Dota. It's a thing.
Fuck Sunday Night Football, motherfuckers. Sunday Night Dota. Are you ready for some Dota?
Oh my God, I would be so into this. But it's good. I like to see this. I know we've had this discussion in a previous version of the 72-Pin Connector podcast, but esports are a sport, and I'm excited. As a person who loves watching this stuff, it's only going to get bigger.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. It'll be fun. I think they're helping mainstream this even more than what the League and Dota already is. But
yeah,
it'll get there in time. I don't think it'll ever be the Olympics, but...
Well, no.
I don't know. I mean, snowboarding made it, and previously that was in the X Games alone. A lot of the stuff from the X Games has now moved into the actual Olympics.
And I think esports is in X Games now, isn't
yes, it? Yes, it is. So I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, I'm not going to say next year or anything, or even by 2020, but I would bet by about 2040, we'll see eSports actually make it into the Olympics. And that's going to have some really huge challenges, because what patch level are you playing on? When you have 4 years between, you know, Olympic games, Olympic style tournaments, do you set like, okay, this is our Olympic patch and you've got an Olympics meta versus a latest meta versus a TI meta? I mean, there's a lot there to manage, especially if you're a team looking to go to the Olympics and to TI and to all these smaller competitions.
I'll tell you what it would mean right now. It means that all games would be that are in there would be regulated by the IOC, and Valve would no longer be able to just institute updates whenever they wanted.
That would be interesting. I don't know if they would do that.
It would be weird.
That would be really weird.
The IOC would be involved at that point.
I don't know if I like that idea.
But yeah, it'll be fun. Hopefully something like that would start to happen. I would like to see an international governing body and see what they would do with it. Just out of intrigue. Not because I think it needs to happen. I'm just curious to see what would happen.
And you're also not going to get the post-TI shuffle that always happens in Dota 2, where, you know, literally hours after the international ends, everyone's like, yeah, I quit this team. Fuck these guys. These guys are noobs. And they go to like six different other teams. And you can't ever like a team because the team this month is not the team the next month.
Well, that's also going to be changing because of Blizzard. Blizzard's going to be what changes that. But that's enough of eSports. Fuck the Asian games. They're ahead of us. It makes me upset. I want to be an Olympic all-star, and the only way I can do that's if video games are there.
You got to move to South Korea. You got to just do it.
I'm good. Speaking of e-games or esports, League of Legends and Twitch has a cool interaction coming forward.
Yeah,
I don't know if you guys have seen about this.
Yeah, I looked at that.
I would love to see this happen more often in different games. So what's happening is Twitch is going to get some game information from League of Legends for casters. So when someone's casting, Twitch will be able to detect what the hero is and what their rank is. So that if you want to watch people of a certain caliber of player, or you just want to watch a certain player character being used, you can jump to whoever in it right there.
This is huge.
Mm-hmm.
So
this will actually drive me to use Twitch proper instead of using their API to pull streams out.
It's going to be really nice, as well as I think this is going to help possibly Twitch build more of a game framework, and not just a streaming framework, but actually more game integration with Twitch itself.
So as a Dota fan, and I'm sure Dota is going to be on this list at some point in time, but if I want to see like Rubick being played, so I'm like, okay, I want to play some Rubick. I think I like the character, but I want to see how the pros are using Rubick and sort of their strategies around this hero. I can now go to Twitch, click on Rubick, and watch, you know, the best people with the most viewers play this one hero, so I can try to emulate them or learn from them. This is cool. And I'm sure, Adam, you're going to have to speak to this, but do the types of cars you choose in Rocket League, how much of a difference does that make? Is there a meta around van teams versus the sprint teams versus whatever?
No, not Merc.
There are a small handful of cars that all the pros play. The differences of the cars really don't matter until you get that good. I mean, there are cars that are tall cars and there are cars that are flat cars, and that's the biggest difference. But it's, you know, to anybody relatively new, it's not going to matter. The difference is pretty minuscule.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not like Dota where hero to hero has an actual, the way you play has to be different.
Yeah, what I can say is if Rocket League were to have the same options in Twitch, car selection wouldn't be one of the filters.
It would be ranks. You would want to be watching Grand Champions.
Yeah, it'd be ranks.
Okay.
So this, but this Twitch categorization thing, this filtering for specific games, this is going to, I want to see what this does to smaller streamers. You know, because right now, if you click on a game in Twitch, it's going to populate, you know, the list of people with the most viewers, which aren't necessarily the best players of that game. or yes. even necessarily the most interesting.
Yes, I see where you're going. I like this.
So let's say a really high level, Dota or Rocket League player, or whatever, starts streaming for the first time. They don't have a fan base, but they're really good at the game. If people sort by rank, they're going to be much more likely to come in contact with that person's stream than, you know, the current system.
And I think that is great.
Oh, yeah. This is mm-hmm. awesome.
Yes.
It's a little too difficult to break the top because people at the top, like you said, they have huge fan bases. Mm-hmm. And you may have like top 0.1 percentile player only has 2 viewers and 10 subscribers.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen people like esports stars, and this was, you know, a year or so ago, jump on their Twitter account, which has, you know, X number of 10,000 followers, just to say, hey, I'm starting this Twitch thing. Can you follow me over here to boost my numbers? Which, I mean, yeah, that's one way to do it. It's totally valid to do that, but they really shouldn't have to. Tapping into your actual ranking will make discovery so much easier. And on top of that, let's say you're not an esports star. Let's say you're fucking great at Rocket League, but you've got the confirmation bias where you're like, I think I'm okay at Rocket League, but I'm probably not pro level, right? Or a game with a you know, a more nebulous ranking system other than Rocket League, where you don't know exactly where you stand in relation to the pros. Mm-hmm. Now all of a sudden you've got a bunch of Twitch streamers, or Twitch viewers following you. Now all of a sudden teams are taking notice and they're like, holy shit, that Datum guy is fucking good. Do you want to play for Na'Vi? And you're like, no, I want to pick a team that wins. Right? Like, I think this is going to be great for a lot of different people. I cannot wait till this comes to more games.
Yes.
This is going to be fun. I hope this succeeds, because then Twitch can't do this on their own. Game companies have to partner with them.
Yes.
I could see Rocket League jumping on board with this, because Rocket League seems to be fairly progressive in the way they do things. Mm-hmm. I think Dota is going to drag their feet, I'll be honest.
Valve doesn't move quickly on anything. That said, they've got the API built in. So if you follow anything like, what did I just blank on their name? There's a website that does Dota tracking and stuff like that. They've got the open API. They have the ability to jack into this stuff. It's just not well publicized. Like, you actually have to dig around on their site to get any developer information at all.
The actively playing thing, though, will take a lot of game integration. I don't think any games currently do.
Dota Buff is the one I'm thinking of.
Yeah, you're thinking Dota Buff, but Dota Buff doesn't give you this current game you're using this hero. It tells you afterwards.
So you can actually, if you look at Dota Tracker will actually show you even map positions with the whatever delay you set in the client for your stream delay.
Oh.
You can get up to the second updates within that, you know, set delay on whatever your stream client is.
I stand corrected.
Yeah, so you can get Dota Tracker is awesome. I want to call out this website because it's fucking great, especially if you're at work and you can't sit and watch Twitch all day. You can. Oh, I'm sorry. It's trackdota.com. So if you go here, they've got all the leagues, live, popular games. They hook into Twitch metadata. They hook into Dota's API. They're wonderful, but you can get those up-to-the-minute stats with their API. So someone like Twitch could absolutely hook into this.
And like I said, it'd be fun. It'd be good. Love to see it. Something else that's fun is Nintendo killed off the NES Classic. They've already had rumors coming out from, I think, Eurogamer or some other places that the SNES Classic is supposed to be coming out this fall. So possibly one of their most loved systems is going to be running the Classic run.
Fucking hate Nintendo.
I'm not surprised at all. I mean, it's logical that the next step would be an SNES Classic.
I'm ready for that. N64 Classic, just because I want to get four fucking controllers running GoldenEye again.
I just don't understand. I just don't get it. So you build the NES Classic. It flies off the shelves. There's still fucking demand for the console. If you look on eBay, everyone's going nuts. Like, oh my God, here's $12,000 to play something I could just download ROMs for. Or buy games on the virtual console. And they're like, we think we're done with this now. Go buy the Switch. Oh, wait, we're going to make the SNES Classic. By the way, there's four of them.
Yeah, four.
And they're all on eBay right now. Like, I'm happy it's coming out. It's great. It's going to sell well. It's going to do great things for Nintendo. But they aren't going to have the supply. They aren't going to keep this thing alive. It's going to have a run of like 6 months. And they're going to go, Nintendo's going to say, okay, we're bored now. And they're going to cancel the entire project.
Well, it's not a cancel. So, it's not designed to be a long-term run.
Nintendo is the fucking Google of video game companies. They're like, okay, we're going to build this really rad thing, get everyone hyped for it, and then murder it in 2 weeks.
Right. Well, one part of the article that I saw, it looks like one of the reasons that they're stopping production on the NES Classic is because they're working on the SNES Classic.
Why don't they just bring back the Nintendo? Why don't they come out with the Nintendo Classic and it has, you know, NES to N64?
Because part of
instead of selling one console, console, they can sell two or three.
No, that's not just that's true. Part of it also isn't just playing the games. It's not that. It's the idea people are seeing these things like, holy shit, that looks just like an NES. I used to have one of those. I want one of that. It looks like it. If you just have a black box that plays Nintendo games, it's not going to sell as well as a console that is a miniature version of what it is. It just won't. It's a collector's piece. It's not necessarily just for the games.
What if they made this Franken console that's like, kind of looks like all the consoles put together? Like, you got the flap from the NES, but then you know you got the
upright loader of the N64 and SNES.
You got the slider power button from the SNES, and
I would love
whatever else.
I'm gonna jump on the chat room hype train here and call for the Dreamcast Classic. By far the most underrated system of all goddamn time.
I absolutely loved my Dreamcast. Died on me eventually, but God, I love that thing.
Oh, it was so good. And it just, the only thing that killed it is timing. Like, it came out and it was the best thing ever. And then Sony's like, oh yeah, we have this PlayStation 2 thing. Sorry,
$999.
I was there. I was in line. I dropped $400 on a bundle. I got home. I remember, like, the day I got my Dreamcast, or soon after, like at least that week, there was a fucking tornado warning and the sirens were blaring. So, you know, instead of me running to the basement and getting cover, I unhooked my fucking Dreamcast and I took it to the basement with me. Because if my house is getting torn apart, I'm not losing that goddamn Dreamcast. I had my priorities set as a kid. Like, I knew what I wanted.
So the Dreamcast was a cool system. It had some fun games. And I think it might have been part of the short run, but I mean, it still didn't have, it had probably about 5 or 6 games. I'm like, yes, this is fucking rad. But other than that, I mean, it was just kind of eh.
It had the best version of Tony Hawk. Yeah. It had Jet Grind Radio, or Jet Set Radio is the proper title, with some of the best music ever. Sonic Adventure sucks. It does. I'm sorry, everyone. I loved it as a kid, but it fucking sucks.
I had a lot of fun with it, but
it's a terrible game. Go back and play it sometime. It's on Steam. I own it.
Yeah, I have it on Steam, and I played it, and I was like, oh, this isn't as good as I remember it.
Yeah, it's so bad. But you've got Crazy Taxi, which was an arcade perfect port, because I want to say the arcade machines ran on very similar hardware back in the day.
Well, I remember seeing arcade machines, like the Dreamcast logo would pop up or whatever on some of them.
They had House of the Dead, I believe.
Yeah. I had House of the Dead on Dreamcast.
They had Typing of the Dead. They actually had a full keyboard for Phantasy Star Online you could play Typing of the Dead on, which by far is the best typing tutorial game out there. Suck it, Mario.
And I want to elaborate for everyone out there that's writing furiously in chat. When I say game titles, I mean, like, if I can't play this game anywhere else.
Right, I see what you mean.
I mean, there's a lot of games that go cross. Were on other, like, I'm not going to call NBA on NBC awesome because there was fucking NBA Jam, and they're the same fucking thing. Yes, it was awesome, yeah. But that's not a reason to buy the console because you can get that anywhere else.
So 2K and the 2K sports library on the Dreamcast were by far the best sports games ever created in that era, because they did the dynamic announcer thing, which was the first of its kind at the time, where they would be able to call out player names if they had them registered in the database and say, you know, Joe Smith takes the ball up the 40 and he scores a touchdown. It wasn't good, but it was amazing at the time. I remember playing a hockey game where they would actually have like ice trails from the player's skates in the ice, and it would stick there until between periods. It was, oh my god, it was I fucking love the Dreamcast.
They had Rush was the shit. That is the one game for that console that I will always give it credit for.
Yes,
I forgot about Rush.
The stunt mode, man. That fucking stunt mode. Yes,
the stunt mode. Oh man. Now you got me wanting to play that.
That is the kind of game I'd love to see come back. Fuck skateboard stunts. I'm a fucking rocket cars with wing stunts. I mean, Rocket League has it.
You can kind of do that, yeah.
Throw some damn fins on it. Let's do it.
So when is Psyonix going to come out with Rocket League Rush is what I want to know.
Rocket League Rush.
Yes.
Rush Rocket League.
God damn.
Sounds like the Rocket League Rush update.
So instead of having boost, you jump and you have wings. So you have to hit boost pads to actually get speed to fly, or you have to jump off the walls to coast.
So with their modding tools, maybe it might fit into that framework.
Rush It League.
Yes. I love it.
Thank you, Sad Mouth Piano.
But yeah, so.
Yeah.
SNES Classic. Odds are coming out this winter. Be interesting.
Odds are discontinued by next winter.
Yes.
Odds are supply is too low and people can't get a hold of them.
But it's odds happening.
Are you should just get a RetroPie.
It doesn't look like an SNES.
It doesn't look like an SNES, but you can 3D print a case. I saw a 3D printed Raspberry Pi case that looks like an NES. It even has a functioning power button if you had a spring.
You can buy an old SNES that's not working or something for $2 on Craigslist.
You could, but then when you try to buy Earthbound, it costs you $80. Or you try to buy Chrono Trigger, and it costs you $100.
He's saying use the shell.
You can gut it out. Yeah, you can use the shell if you want it to look like an SNES.
Okay.
Buy an SNES and gut it out. I've got a Nintendo upstairs that didn't work anymore, so I took the cover off and I took some of the guts out, and it's like a little storage thing. I keep my change in there.
I was going to say, it's a good bank.
Yeah.
So something Nintendo did that worked really well was Mario Maker. People loved it. It was actually one of the best things probably on the Wii U, because the integration with the pad to the TV was well done.
Mm-hmm.
And to go with this Maker trend, Namco said, you know what? Pac-Man should be able to do this. So they have announced that they announced in Europe, they put a trademark on the name Pac-Man Maker. So there is a very good chance that we are going to see a map-making Pac-Man edition.
That would be cool. That would be really cool.
And this is interesting.
I'm curious to see if it's going to be 2D and 3D, because some people may forget there was a 3D variant of Pac-Man.
I'm waiting to see if it's just the maze-gobbling Pac-Man, or if I can make levels for Pac-Man Adventures 2.
Oh, God.
Am I the only one that played Pac-Man Adventures 2?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I think you are, actually.
Okay. I fucking love that game.
It's important to state, and it's kind of obvious, but, you know, just because they trademark something doesn't mean that it's even in the works at all.
Nintendo trademarks fucking everything.
Right. Look at the copyright for the Nintendo NX controller.
Yeah.
And it, so outside of having a touch screen that could be used in between the controllers, it is nothing like the Switch ended up. Nothing at all.
I wonder how far this could last though. So for Mario Maker, right, you've got umpteen different blocks and enemies and physics types, and it just Mario as a series has reinvented itself so many times and added stuff on. Of course, if you make a Mario Maker, you can make some cool shit with that. Pac-Man though, and correct me if I'm wrong, but Pac-Man's been relatively stagnant. Yeah, you can make different maze types, but I don't know if this is going to have the same staying power. I would almost guarantee that it wouldn't. I wouldn't think so,
no.
It won't have the same staying power, but it will be a nice novelty of people make maps. It's deemed a hard map, and everyone sees how high of a score they can get on that map.
Yeah, it'd be interesting.
It's going to be a high score, like leaderboard kind of thing.
I could see some interesting shit coming out of this. Now, I really don't want to discount, and I want to make sure that people understand, when you give something to the internet at large, they will fucking surprise you, and sometimes in horrifying ways. I should say most of the time in horrifying ways. Mm-hmm. So if they do put out Pac-Man Maker, I'm sure some cool shit's going to come out of it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, look at the original Forge on Halo 3. Everyone thought, they're just going to like put some like walls up in the middle of maps and shit. People are making Krogoth like structures in the middle of these maps. They're just making these huge sculptures. They're making these racetracks that have nothing to do with the map they're on that you have to race through. I mean, when you give the internet something to create with, you're going to see some crazy fucking shit.
They'll create it. Yeah.
Didn't they make like Warthog ramp maps or Warthog racing maps?
Yeah,
well, they made all kinds of stuff.
Mongoose racing maps. You would have like a path that was just, you'd go upside down on some, you'd have jumps. They made them hard as hell. You'd have fusion coils dropping, so you have explosions randomly on them, and they were fun.
God damn.
I miss Halo 3.
I so regret the fact that Time Splitters 2 didn't come out during the big internet era. Because Time Splitters 2 had a pretty good map maker, and I made some cool shit. Also, Time Splitters 1 was shit. I love Time Splitters 2 so much. I played the hell out of it. Like, I got everything, and I went back. I was like, okay, Time Splitters 1 on the PS2. All right, it's like $4. Wow. It must be because Time Splitters 3 is right around the corner. There's no way this game could ever be that cheap. And I got it home, and it was trash. The whole game was so shitty. It was like if someone built maps in Unreal Tournament and filled it with random bots and said, oh, it's single player now. Just get to this other end of the map. And that was the entire game. It was awful.
Oh, yes. That's unfortunate.
So we'll see where that goes. It may never, like Adam pointed out, it may never even come to sea. So
it might not. Yeah. One thing that probably will happen that I'm sure we're going to be waiting at least the next 3 years for is another game that we can have the coffee and blow hour with, other than The Witness. And it does not have a name. Jonathan Blow did tease a little piece of a new game he's been working on. It's a guy pushing blocks around. But if you've played any Jonathan Blow game, we could say stuff like, well, it's sort of like Mario with time travel, or, well, you can draw lines on shit, or, well, there's a dude and he pushes blocks around. But you can never boil down a Jonathan Blow game into a simple sentence and have it be anywhere near accurate.
Okay. Right. So for those of you who aren't familiar, Jonathan Blow is the lead developer and brainchild behind Braid and The Witness. He was talking at a dev or a developer conference for game devs, and he had a 3-hour presentation. And during part of his presentation, he was elaborating on something he was talking about, and he showed a 2-minute or 3-minute clip of this new game that he's working on. And he prefaced it by saying, it's fully functional, the game is complete, but I'm not showing you any more because I don't want to have a damn press release about it yet.
Whoops. So, of course, the gaming press got a hold of this, and everyone's freaking out and hyping all over the place. Jonathan Blow is making something else. Everyone panic.
Yeah.
So
we're doing our part by panicking.
No, it's...
So panicked.
It looks weird. Well, I'll wait and see. I like Braid. I like The Witness. But I'm not going... Both those games were very different from each other. I'm not going to hook myself to his wagon just because who knows what the fuck this is going to be. He doesn't have a set thing that he's in.
I am so hooked to the wagon. Like if it started going off a cliff, I'd go off with it. Like I am tied to the wagon.
Yeah. So I looked a little bit at this clip, and from what I understand, what you see in the clip, like you said, he said the game was almost done pretty much, but what you see in the clip is not the finished game. It's very much missing art stuff.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
So it's don't look at the clip and be like, oh, this looks like crap. This doesn't look good at all. I think given his track record of making, kind of more cerebral, artsy, some would say pretentious, difficult kind of puzzle games, I think, we can kind of know what to expect a little bit.
it's going to be in that puzzling. Regard. And yeah, that's all we know.
But not necessarily with the gameplay or story or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Is it going to be a platformer? Is it going to be drawing lines on things?
Is it going to be a cover-based shooter where you can move your own cover?
Is it going to be a typing game? I mean, come on. Yeah. We really don't know. Maybe he had to type words to get his character to move to certain blocks.
I all I know is I'm really excited because Jonathan Blow is making whatever something
it
else.
Is, yeah, whatever it is, I'm excited to see what it is, and then I'm probably going to be pretty excited to play it. So
yeah.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I will try it. It's just I'm not going to allow myself to get hyped about something he's making until I know the form of what that game is.
Yeah. Like me and Tom are totally hyped about Death Stranding and we don't even know what it is.
And I repeatedly keep saying this could be fucking garbage. Yeah. It could be great. It could be garbage.
But let's not harp on that because we bring that up every other podcast or so.
Yeah. Well, it's another one of our themes.
So Rocket I want to talk about Death Stranding a little bit.
Get out of here.
Then we're going to delve into some Dark Souls and some Rocket League.
Also, there were a few... game announcements. I will hit these in rapid fire real quick. Micro Mini Machines. This is a throwback to an NES game. It's a racing game. Looks like they might have a little bit of battling in it. They're bringing in a new release of it. It's going to be a throwback remake of the old one.
So, this is weird.
I don't know if you guys have ever played them. It was enjoyable.
It was a good game.
Think RC Pro-Am, only less upgradey and more random shit. Like you're driving around on a pool table or you're driving around on a cluttered desk. It's fun.
You know, all those in like Unreal Tournament, all the giant maps where you're like an ant and running around like a kitchen and you can hop on plates and stuff. That game on the NES was basically the birth of that phenomenon where you are really tiny in the game.
Yeah. Army men. Whatever it's called, when you're the green army people. I think
it's just called Army Men.
Army Men, yeah. Army Men. Sarge's Heroes. Sarge's Heroes is one of my favorites. But it's that kind of feel where you're walking through a kitchen and this thing's fucking huge. But that's because you're an inch tall action figure.
Yeah, Micro Machines World Series. So part of this showed it was like the cars were in a little hungry hippos.
Yeah, they're playing, they're racing on a hungry hippos thing. There's going to be all sorts of mini games, especially in current gens.
Yeah, so it looked like there's a lot of battle stuff, racing stuff.
I'm kind of looking forward to it.
It looked like a fun party game.
If it's like $30-$40, I think that's the max I would pay. If it's a $60 release, it better have some really good shit to show me.
Yeah, I really don't see that though.
Neither do I.
I really hope that big AAA developers, or even, you know, like B developers, will understand that, hey, we can put out a game at $30 and people aren't going to be expecting, you know, the world's best graphics or an orchestral soundtrack. Like if you just put out a fun Micro Machines game at $20 or $30, bucks, I'll buy it if it's a good time.
Yes, but at the same time, are you willing to pay $100 for a game?
It depends on the game, right? If Jonathan Blow comes out and he says
the best game of all time, maybe.
if Jonathan Blow comes out and says, okay, it's only got programmer art and it's a cover-based shooter where you push blocks to make your own cover. Also, everything in the game is brown or gray. I would absolutely pay $100 for that.
You get what I'm saying. Us gamers always want to see games cheaper, but if they raise the price on a game or something around a game, we go screaming.
It depends on the game. Like if Star Citizen came out, if Star Citizen came out and they said, okay, we've actually hit all of our promises. Here's our reviews that show this is the best space simulator ever created. And by the way, you can have it today for the low cost of $100 and we're, you know, running servers online and bullshit. Absolutely, I would pay for it.
Well, what I'm saying
is it depends on the content and the quality of the game. You know, we've got a baseline price of $60 for a new AAA release,
which hasn't changed in years. Right. Price of game development has increased a ton.
Absolutely. So,
but the market has increased.
Regardless, But if we're looking at these games, you know, if there's a game that's $100, it's going to have a lot more content. It's going to have to be more polished. There better not be any bugs, Bethesda.
yeah, I've never paid that for a Bethesda.
No, God, no.
I mean, hell, they did a fucking remaster and added more bugs. What the fuck?
Perfect.
It's features.
Classic
features. Yes, I forgot. I got to speak like a developer. They're features.
Yeah, it's comical features. It's the charm of the game.
But, I've never been one of those, I think.
If a company could come out with a game that is just phenomenal, it's got excellent graphics, it's got a good story, you know, it's got a lot of content, something you could put a lot of hours into, maybe $100 would be worth it.
We
maybe
say that hypothetically, but if Zelda was $100, people would be shitting all over Nintendo right now.
So let me ask you guys,
because that's true.
We don't have a group topic. What game would you pay $100 for? What's worth $100 in Europe? Is Skyrim worth $100? To me, no. I'd say no.
I don't think
so. Rocket League worth $100?
Honestly, with the amount of hours I've put in, I would probably... Actually, I'd probably pay...
No. I have already spent more than $100 in Rocket League, I'm pretty sure.
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Same with Dota 2. Yeah. I mean, Dota 2, I've put in hundreds of hours, right? I've played that more than any other game. It is. But
that's also...
You know, if I had to re-op every year and Valve asked for $25 every year for me to be able to play that game, I would probably pay it, right? World of Warcraft asked for $15 a month. Was that worth it to me back in the day? Oh, absolutely. Would I pay it again right now? Probably not.
Yeah.
I think that's an interesting idea, the fact of what would happen if a game was to say we're $60 up front, and after the first year you have to pay us $20 a year to keep playing. That way they would get continuous flux of money to support this community. And if the community waivers, they don't have the money to support it, so the game starts to die.
Almost every MMO that's come out has done that. With the big glorious exception is Guild Wars, where you pay for the game and then you just buy expansions. But almost every MMO has got the 60 up front, 15 every month price point.
Well, I'm saying like an actual, like, let's say COD. It's 60 up front. You get all the free DLC. That first year is done. It's essentially you're buying a season pass for that year.
Yeah. And if something like COD stopped relying on year, and I don't even like Call of Duty, so I can't really speak to whether or not I'd pay for this. For me, you know, something like Counter-Strike or Call of Duty, we'll say that, where they said, hey, you know, here's $60, here's your season pass, and you've got to pay $25 to maintain your online connectivity. You know, you can play split screen all you want, but to get into the servers, you've got to pay $25, you know, every year to maintain your subscription. But they stopped putting out yearly releases. I think people would pay for that. And frankly, I think it would be better for Call of Duty in general. They could balance and work on one game instead of working on a game every single fucking year that just gets shittier and shittier.
Right.
If Valve did that, and they sort of do with it, you can still play, but if you want the latest, greatest maps, you can pay the, what is it, like $6 to get their challenge coins and get access to the newest stuff right away. But yeah, I think I'd pay that for something like Counter-Strike or Dota. And it just makes sense from a game design. If you can guarantee that the company is going to support it and use your $25 every year to make the game better or to keep the servers running, yes, but the moment a company like Ubisoft or EA comes out and they say, oh, yeah, we're totally supporting this game. Oh, by the way, guys, fuck off for coming out with, you know, Call of Assassins 3 next year. So we're not going to do anything else. Well, if you want to play online, give us more money.
Well, I mean, to me, like my ideal of that, I'll just real quick and out because we've spent enough time, but like Madden, I think Madden's a great candidate for this. $60 buy the game, $20 a year, you get all the updates for that year. If you don't want a year, you don't pay for that year, pay for the next, you're right back in.
Yeah, because they have to do rosters, there's licensing deal with the NFL and the players unions.
And they always add new features to the game.
They do, yeah.
They're small, but there's always something new.
Yeah, Madden should absolutely go to a rolling model.
Okay, and then one more release I want to get to, and then I think we're about wrapped. Next week, the Switch is finally getting one of the big titles that it's been waiting for, Mario Kart 8 Deluxe. So Mario Kart 8, widely seen as one of the best Mario Karts to be made, is getting remade on the Switch with all the DLC included, a couple extra racers, and a battle mode. So they are correcting everything that was possibly wrong with the game and bundling it all up in one package for the Switch.
I will absolutely be buying this when I get my Switch. If I ever get my Switch, Nintendo, make some more goddamn consoles.
I will be getting this game the day before I go to an airport, so I will be playing Mario Kart in the air, baby.
Oh, nice.
Nice.
Yeah.
Just don't scream ba-bomb on the plane.
Oh, my God. Oh,
that would be bad.
Someone throws a bomb. Oh, fuck!
Especially if you're flying United.
I say you're flying United. They'll open the emergency exit and kick you out.
Which I'm going to be flying United, so I'm going to bring my boxing gloves.
Yeah. So are you sitting in first class or Fight Club?
No, I'm sitting in Economy Fight Club right there by the wings.
Oh, by the animal exhibits?
Nice.
With all the scorpions and stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, free zoo.
There's an obstacle course on the way to my seat. I have to pass through barbed wire and the like.
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah, just bring a level 3 helmet, maybe a frying pan.
God. Why has no one used the United logo with the Dark Souls text?
I'll definitely equip my frying pan for sure.
They need the United logo.
And a cast iron.
Dark Souls text, prepare to fly. Why has no one done this? We need to do this right now.
That would be really good.
Oh, that's perfect.
Okay, well, I think that's about all we got for you guys this week. If you got any suggestions what you'd like us to talk about or any fun shit like that, or what you would like us to be cooking, anything at all, just tweet at us at 72PCPodcast on Twitter. If you're watching us live, we do have a YouTube where we upload all of this and some occasional short films or clips, which we're really in desperate need to start updating some
short films. We are very pretentious.
You can just find us on YouTube there. Or if you're on our YouTube, you can watch us live. We're going to have a set schedule soon. It's about to get a little messy for the next 3 weeks, but typically it will now be Saturdays at 9 p.m. Eastern. But next week, we are going back to our Friday time slot of 10 p.m. Eastern because I have to fly on Saturday. So with that, until next week, game on.
See everyone.
Bye.
Form, paperwork.
Wait. Benefits, healthcare. 401k.